On Point with Craig's Investment Partners.
The information provided here is general in nature. It's not financial advice. It doesn't take into account your financial situation, objectives, goals, or risk tolerance. All investments are subject to risks and none are guaranteed. So before you make any investment decisions, we recommend you contact an investment advisor. For more information about our services in that regard, you can go to our website, which is craigsip.com. Welcome to On Point. I'm Mark Lister, Investment Director at Craig's Investment Partners, and I'll be talking about a range of topics, including economics, portfolio strategy, investor education, and anything else that's happening out there in financial markets. It's been a difficult few years for first home buyers. Just as borrowing costs started falling in 2020, prices started rising sharply, and that offset any extra spending capacity that buyers had. The pandemic also meant falling job security as those lockdowns really started to take their toll. By the time the dust settled and prices started coming back down to earth, mortgage rates had started to rise again, and quite rapidly. While they didn't go as high as they did during the GFC era of 2008, the pace of the increases was something we hadn't seen since the 1980s. That spooked buyers, as did the near 20% fall in house prices, which was also something we hadn't seen for at least 40 years. However, if you think it's tough having been left on the sidelines, count yourself lucky that you didn't buy in 2021. Some of those folk had to stomach a tripling of their mortgage payments, and at the same time they watched the equity in their biggest asset evaporate. The housing market did stabilise early last year. Prices bottomed out in about May 2023, and obviously now we've started to see mortgage rates heading south. So where does that leave potential buyers? And is now a good time to pounce on that first home? On balance, I think it is, yes. But at the same time, I don't think property is going to power ahead as much as some might think. Falling mortgage rates will be the key driver of a more buoyant housing market in the next year or two, and prices are very sensitive to interest rates and the cost of borrowing. However, the official cash rate is likely to settle a little higher than we've seen in recent years, maybe in that 2.5% to 3.5% zone instead of something lower than that, and that could mean that the new normal for mortgage rates is about 5% rather than being 3 or 4%. Policy changes will also help the market, with triple CFA restrictions having softened and the return of interest deductibility for investors. Migration will be supportive too, even though it is well down from its highs and heading lower. On the other side of the coin, the costs of home ownership have increased sharply in recent years. While interest rates are coming down, higher insurance, rates, and property maintenance costs are all here to stay. The labour market is also expected to weaken further, despite the expected string of interest rate cuts we're likely to see. The unemployment rate has increased to 4.6%, up from a multi-decade low of 3.2% in 2022. Reserve Bank projections suggest that it will keep rising and peak at about 5.4% next year. When people don't feel confident about their job security, they're more cautious about borrowing, buying, and spending decisions. The biggest headwind of all for the housing market, though, could be that affordability remains very low and that prices are still really high compared to history. The Real Estate Institute's National House Price Index fell by 18.1% between November 2021, that was the peak, and May 2023. And since then, prices have flatlined. They haven't moved much at all. Now, that was a big fall between late 2021 and early 2023, the biggest we've seen in decades. However, don't forget that house prices surged almost 50% in the 2 years leading up to that 2021 peak. Now, that's a staggering rise, especially when you consider that the average annual gain since 1990 has been 5.9% per annum. So even after that big fall, prices are still 22% higher than they were at the end of 2019, just before the pandemic hit. According to CoreLogic, gross rental yields nationally are about 3.2%, while in Auckland, rental yields on average are even lower at about 2.6%. Now, those are higher than we saw in 2022 when prices were much closer to that peak, but it's still below where those rental yields have typically sat in the past. So unless an investor can see opportunities to add value to a property, those levels of income, which are before costs, remember, you've got to pay for your rates and your insurance, your maintenance and your property management out of that, those levels of income still might not excite them as much as you would like. When you put all of that together, I do still think it's a good time to buy, especially for first home buyers. If you're lucky enough to have a deposit and funding in place for a mortgage, you're in a very good position and you're much luckier than many. Now, as interest rates keep coming down, there will be more competition. More buyers will enter the fray and their purchasing firepower will increase. That does suggest it'll get harder rather than easier from here, especially if house prices start moving up at the same time. And I wouldn't be surprised if that happens. If I had to guess, I would definitely say the worst is behind us in terms of the housing market and that we will see a recovery over the coming years. Prices are in a slump, but lower interest rates should ensure that we do see that rebound ahead. However, I would be banking on modest gains rather than spectacular ones, something along the lines of that 5-6% annual average that we've seen over the long term, rather than the double-digit gains we've seen at times in the past. So there you go, that's my take. Yes, it is a good time to buy a house, in my opinion, especially for first home buyers. Prices should rise over the next year or two, but expect those gains to be more modest and more aligned with what we've seen over the long term, rather than what you saw during that very buoyant period of the low interest rates during the COVID era, or those double-digit gains we've seen through other times in history.
For more insights, visit craigsip.com.